As a proud alumna of Dartmouth College, I sometimes think about my very first moments on campus. Like when I came up the hill and I saw Baker Tower Library for the first time, and I got that fluttery heart feeling of excitement and nerves. And later that day, when my mom dropped me off at the dorm and she said to me, "Honey, it's time to go spread your wings and fly." You know, I felt like flying. I felt inspired that day to create a new future for myself. And I imagine that you've had moments like this too, times when you've been excited to imagine and create what's next. Right now, as individuals and as a global community, we need to be looking ahead and planning what's next. We have an urgent need and an unprecedented opportunity to be learning from this past year and rethinking how we will work best, learn best, and function best as a society going forward. But most people I talk to right now, they're not feeling particularly inspired to think about and plan for the future. Most people I talk to right now feel stressed out, tired, and burned out from everything that's happened this past year. Things like the loss of a traditional educational experience, or the grief of losing someone close to you, or the trauma many frontline workers have felt seeing the effects of COVID firsthand, or the isolation many felt being at home alone, away from their families and colleagues, or the exhaustion many felt juggling parenting while working from home. Although each of our individual struggles have looked different, what we all share in common right now is the fact that we have all had these moments this past year, these moments when we felt tested, pushed to the limit, crucible moments. It is no wonder that we are exhausted and that burnout is on the rise. And when we're burned out, what we know from researcher Christina Maslach is that we feel physically exhausted, increasingly negative and cynical about our lives, and we also feel this lack of personal accomplishment, like we can't get things done, almost like a powerlessness. It sort of feels like we're wrapped in this chrysalis where we just feel restricted and constrained in everything that we do. How can we possibly reimagine and create a better future when we're burned out? It's an important question and one that I've been wrestling with. I'll begin to answer it by first just geeking out with you for a minute on word etymologies and definitions, because that's kind of a thing for me. So the word reimagine originally comes from the Latin word imago, which means image. So to reimagine is like seeing a new or different image. But in modern times, scientists use the term imago to mean an adult phase of an insect, when they grow their wings. Maybe it's what my mom was unknowingly alluding to during my first adult experience in life when she told me to spread my wings and fly. When you think about it, wings of flight, they represent that freedom, that openness, that confidence and courage we feel when we are inspired to look ahead and create what's next. Whether it's something like beginning college, or the invention of a new business product or strategy, or rapidly producing a new vaccine, or trying to put the first human being on Mars. In all of these cases, inspiration is a fuel that propels us forward to take action. Inspiration is quite literally the opposite of burnout, and it is a powerful fuel to lead us through change. But here's the problem. Even though we know we want inspiration and need it, most of us don't think about it as something that we can create for ourselves. Think about it. Looking back in time, history books, religious texts, and artists have referred to inspiration as this unexpected thing that just descends upon you like a muse. Here you see a painting of one of my favorite Renaissance artists, Caravaggio, and it's called The Inspiration of St. Matthew. Inspiration is depicted as this person coming down from the ceiling. This is how we think about it. It's unexpected, it's out of our control, and it just suddenly appears. Today, I want to take the mystery out of inspiration to make it more accessible to you as both an antidote to burnout and a fuel to propel you forward. Over the last 6 years, my colleagues Jen Grace Barron, Sandy Spataro, and I have studied inspiration within business using exploratory qualitative research interviews with nearly 100 leaders across different industries and backgrounds. We've also looked at experimental research that's been done by other colleagues. And what we've learned is that inspiration is unique from other positive emotions that you might experience when you are inspired, like excitement or happiness or joy. When you're specifically inspired, two things are happening. One, you see new possibilities, new ideas that weren't there before. But at the same time that you see these possibilities, you also feel this sudden confidence and courage to take action, even when it's hard. We call that invincibility. So possibility combined with invincibility. Or as my six-year-old son described in his book report, you can do new things, and at the same time, you don't give up. What we've also learned about inspiration is that while it can sometimes suddenly appear, it is something that you can practice and produce for yourself. I want to just try it out right now for a second. If you can, just take a nice deep breath and think about a time that you have felt inspired. Anything that comes up for you. Maybe it was a particular moment or a person that you were around. But think about that moment when you felt possibility and invincibility. And if you can, take yourself back to that moment when you were inspired. Now, as you're picturing it right now, do you feel just the slightest bit of a lift in your energy? Even just a teeny tiny bit. That lift, it's like a fuel. It is a fuel that you can tap into more intentionally and more regularly. And sometimes it's little, like, I'm a little inspired, and sometimes it's big, like, oh, I'm inspired. So when you tap into that feeling every day, even just a little bit, it brings forward your best. The leaders that we talked to and interviewed said that when they were inspired, they definitely felt better, like greater well-being, less burnout. But at the same time, they said they performed better in their jobs. They were better leaders. They were more collaborative, and they were more agile and able to solve complex problems. I cannot imagine a more important time than right now when we need this fuel. So, how do you do it, and where do you begin? You have to rethink how inspiration works. You don't have to wait for it. You can look for it, plan for it, and create it. Did you know that in an average adult lifetime, you're gonna spend roughly 38 days of your life brushing your teeth? Now think about that. That's a lot of time that those minutes every morning and every night add up to. And we do it because we care about our dental hygiene. But wouldn't you want to also at least spend 38 days of your lifetime feeling inspired and doing things that inspire you? So a little bit of time each day can add up to a lot. And the best leaders know this. And what they do is they tap into inspiration every single day, even if it's just a couple minutes here and there. And that's how they're able to stay connected to what matters to them, optimistic and visionary, even during the toughest times. That process of knowing what inspires you and planning for it and seeking out time each day, even for just a few minutes, we call it an inspiration practice. And just like anything you practice, it can get easier and more habitual over time. And what I want to do right now is share with you three tips so that you can begin your inspiration practice. My first tip is to tune in every day to your emotions. You know, sometimes we're in a sort of restricted chrysalis kind of state without even knowing it. So take time each day to tune in, be present, and notice how are you feeling. Are you particularly negative or exhausted or acting out in ways that are unusual? If so, ask yourself, why am I feeling this way and what can I learn from these emotions? This gives you an opportunity to process those emotions using healthy strategies like social connection or creative outlets or breathing, meditation, exercise. And if you feel like you need additional support, therapy is an especially powerful tool to process emotions and definitely something I've leaned on in my lifetime when I've needed it. At the same time, tune in to the types of things that energize you, that inspire you. Is it being out in nature? Is it learning new things from podcasts and books? Is it being around certain types of people who lift you up? What are those things that energize you? When you take time each day to tune into your emotions, it gives you a chance to notice them and learn from them. My second tip to begin your inspiration practice is to look for ways each day to ignite inspiration. Now, in our research, we found 18 distinct strategies that can reliably spark inspiration for you. But what we also discovered is that individuals are unique in terms of what inspires them. So I can't tell you what's going to inspire you. You have to uncover it really for yourself. But what I am going to do is share with you some of our top strategies that we learned about. The first one has to do with purpose. One of my favorite quotes is by the poet Mary Oliver, who said, "Tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life?" Your purpose is your why. It's what gives you meaning. And while many of us may have a bigger life purpose that we think about, what I want to challenge you to do is when you wake up in the morning, think about your micro purpose. What uniquely gives you purpose and meaning today? You know, I asked myself that question this morning, and the answer that I came up with was you. Being here with you, talking about this topic, that's what gives me meaning today. And thinking about it first thing this morning definitely inspired me. Another strategy is called unstructured time. And we learned about it from Dartmouth Psychology Emeritus Professor Dr. Christian Jernsted. He said to us, why is it that we often get our most inspired ideas when we're taking long car rides or in the shower or taking a long walk? And he said, because during these times, we turn off our brains from trying to actively solve problems, and it actually allows our subconscious creative brains to come up with new ideas. Here's an example of this. Jonathan Rivers, who is a technology executive at Fortune, shared how he was feeling burned out and realized that he needed to take a mental health day. On that day, he got up that morning and he Googled the term great tacos, and he hopped on his motorcycle and rode a long ride under the blue skies to discover this new taco joint. And here you see a picture that he shared at this place. He described this day of unstructured time as both freeing and inspiring. He said, I got more deep thinking done in one day than I had in weeks. So try out unstructured time, whether it's a full day of it like Jonathan, or what I do is carve out a few hours each week. Some other strategies that you might think about are finding inspiration in the people around you by connecting more with your mentors, your heroes, the people who lift you up. And also remember that some people can also find inspiration in overcoming obstacles in difficult times, like the situation that we're all in right now. Whether you try out some of the strategies I just mentioned or come up with your own, what's most important is that you're carving out time each day to spark inspiration. My third tip to begin your inspiration practice is to look for ways to lift up others. You know, when I was a kid, I used to love looking through a kaleidoscope. It was this interesting way to look out into the world and see it through a new and colorful lens. Did you know that a group of butterflies all flying in the air together are called a kaleidoscope? Think about that. It's a beautiful image of what it's like when groups of people, whether that be teams or colleagues or communities, are inspired together to effect positive change. We learned in our research from what the best leaders do to inspire others. And I want to share with you one of those strategies. It has to do with connecting everyone around a shared mission. Dr. Michael Yeh, a surgeon from UCLA, once told a story about how he and his surgical team had been working on this young girl's spine for nearly 10 hours. Everyone was exhausted, but the last few minutes of the surgery were critical. They had to get it right or she'd never walk again. So he stopped for a minute, thanked everyone for their hard work, and then he said, "Team, take a deep breath. These next few minutes will be crucial. What I need from you right now is 5 minutes of awesome." And as he said this, it brought everyone together around their shared mission to save this girl's life. We all have an opportunity every single day to positively affect the microsystems around us, whether that be our teams, our colleagues, our communities, even our families. Inspiration truly is contagious. So I began all of this by saying I would take the mystery out of inspiration to make it more accessible to you, to define it for you. And I hope by now that you see that inspiration is something that you can both practice and produce reliably, starting with the three tips that I shared with you. One, the chrysalis, tune into your emotions. Two, butterfly, look for ways to ignite inspiration every single day, even if it's just for a few minutes. And three, kaleidoscope, look for opportunities to lift up others around you every day so that we can be inspired communities of change. As a final thought, I recently learned that while butterflies usually grow their wings after a few days, maybe a couple weeks, if they feel particularly threatened or are in harsh environments, they might stay in their chrysalises for much longer, even years. Right now, I think we can all relate to feeling, to some degree, threatened, afraid, tired, burned out. And while all these emotions are completely normal, what we cannot do is stay in our chrysalises forever. Because we need inspiration right now in so many places, in healthcare, education, business, whether we have big complex problems to solve, we need to be able to generate new solutions and possibilities and invincibly lead those changes that we wish to see. So I ask of you today to choose inspiration by practicing it every single day. Because inspiration lifts us up to take flight individually and collectively so we can envision and create what's next.